Hang on a second.
And your division is 40%, 20%, and then again 40%?
I didn't know. I haven't gone to that level of granularity. So I can walk through that here. Let me just do a screen share and we can look at the budget all together. Hang on a second. All right, so here we are. So the basic resourcing for the first year, the way I would do it, just for the Archain stuff, is four senior developers at 150K each per, that's USD, per annum, essentially dividing them as two devoted to Rolang and RoVM and two devoted to storage and replication proof of stake. This is pretty much starvation, right? If you look at the size of these projects, it's pretty much starvation, but you know, we are where we are. And then we should have one biz dev, so someone who's also playing in the role of technical management and you know, wearing multiple hats. So if you multiply that out, that comes out to 750K USD. Additionally, there will be business operations expenses. This includes legal, accounting, internet presence, and marketing, community outreach, and a bunch of other things that often get missed when you do basic budgeting, but they end up adding up. And so that's about 30K if you lay it all out. And then technical operations would include, you know, everything from making sure that the Archain developers have, you know, in-house servers as well as servers that are up on AWS, CI infrastructure, paying for some licensed software. So we've seen that the use of IntelliJ, for example, as a tool is actually, you know, made a difference in terms of progress. So it's actually a good idea to pay for that, not just get the community version. So things like that. And that ends up adding up when you add it all up. If there are four high-end servers here, that's easily 30K. So that it comes out to about 60K. Fortunately, there doesn't have to be too much revamping in the second year for some of that. And so then in the second year, we would add the expenses of dev and to DevOps. And it's really important to have a DevOps presence pretty early in this, because we want to basically get this out and release it and get it in a basic, be constantly continuously deploying bits through the mechanism that are going to be in the hands of people. And so having that as a part of the process as soon as possible. I'd rather do it in year one, but probably there needs to be a little bit of groundwork laid, and part of that groundwork being laid also is shoring up the team. Right now, we don't have all four of those developers, and we don't have that biz dev person. So there will be some period of time also where we have to, you know, do hiring and interviewing and all that sort of thing. So that's kind of the way to think about it, just from a bare bones budgeting operational side. And then the milestones, from my point of view, we build from the ground up. So first we get the programming model and execution going. So that's Rolang and RoVM. The next step is we get the VM stored on the blockchain. where the blockchain is replicated using, you know, a bet by proposition Casper style proof of stake. So that's the basic thing, and then we need to turn on the metering for the model and set up a token. Here we have some interesting choices. I've talked it over with several people, and the feeling I get from all the people in the space is that going out with sort of the top three coins from the get-go is something that makes a lot of sense and solves solves a number of problems. It also creates some problems, some technical problems, but it solves a certain number of problems and localizes some of the security concerns that I had about the side-by-side architecture in one place. It can all be dealt with once and for all. This is economic security that we're talking about. And then, so what we just discussed was the kind of dividing the core blockchain functions and of our chain into two milestones. Again, as I discussed with Ed earlier, I'm thinking about these in terms of end to end, right? So people can have an experience of working with Rolang and RoVM end to end. You know, they can write a program, which is not necessarily a contract yet, earlier, but in particular when we've hit the milestone, they should be able to write a program, and in fact write lots of programs to test out the compiler and the language design and the VM and all of that. And then blockchain one, they need to be able to write actual contracts, right? So that should be their end-to-end experience. And then blockchain two, those contracts have a decidedly financial flavor, right? So they can write financial contracts and not just information flow style contracts. And then we build up the content delivery on top of that. So basic query and update. And then we build up the attention economy model. And here, it's important to understand, at least from my point of view, I think there's been some discussion in Slack that trying to do both an application and the platform at the same time is biting off more than you can chew. It actually works the other way around. And I know it's counterintuitive, but it's one of those things like in climbing or jujitsu or whatever, where doing what appears to me more ends up being, meaning doing less. So let me try to explain what I mean by that. We're talking about a general purpose programming language, that means you could potentially write graphics programs, and you could write, scientific calculations. There are all kinds of ways that programming language can be utilized, and there's a lot of work that goes into making it support all those different domains. And it's perfectly reasonable to think that a blockchain-based smart contracting language would have all of those capabilities. However, you kind of want to sequence and stage those. And so by scoping it with an application, for example, let's say we take the attention economy model that has been evolving over the last 6 months or so, where we think of a post as a contract, and we think of AMP and Rio is effectively modifying rates at which information flows over channels that are associated with those contracts. In that case, we have a clear application, and so the kinds of contracts that we're writing are focused to deliver on that application. We're not necessarily going to support all vector addition. We're not going to support certain kinds of fancy specialized data types, but we will, make rock solid that surface area of the language that supports these kinds of development efforts, namely, contracts that support the attention economy model. And that's what helps focus the development and keep the development of Rolang and Archain from blooming and blossoming and growing beyond beyond a sustainable scope. So yeah,
I agree with that approach. As long as there isn't the expectation that component on the top is going to finish before the things on the bottom finish.
That's right. I think that's the important thing is that these are loops.
Yeah.
People have to understand that software is iterative, right? And so it's not a waterfall model. It's an iterative model. So, so the next step in all of this, from my point of view, is kind of making sure that these milestones, as I've broken them out, line up with the funding events here. So what we're saying is 0.84K gets you here. And then the next tranche would be roughly 400K. So if we add the 400K, that gets you here. I think that's a bit of a stretch. So I think the tranches might have to be uneven. So I think it might be more like a 500K, 300K kind of thing. Because I think of this as somewhat smaller, but with the potential to get a bit hairy. There are certain aspects of this that include economics, and it's going to need to be reviewed from a lot of different angles, and I'm going to need additional support on that. So that's my thinking there. Again, this looks small. We have a lot of experience with this now. We know that the reactive model works. We know that it does what it's supposed to do, and even if we don't believe in special K, we can put all that to one side, because you know everything from Spark to the reactive frameworks coming out of Microsoft and Facebook all indicate that the basic reactive model is the right way to do this. So I'm not in any way worried or concerned that's not the approach. But it turns out that it can be, even though it's easy to state, it can be somewhat costly. So that's roughly the next 400K chunk. And then this is kind of, we want this to be in the mix, but have I accounted for everything? Yeah, it looks like I've accounted for everything here. So we might have to skimp down here in order to deliver on time and in budget. I'm just going over this, the data in real time here, as dictated by the architecture document and the funds that we're talking about.
A couple of questions on content delivery and the way that it's described here. I assume this is the metered and monetized content delivery as opposed to something that's more basic on the blockchain.
That's correct. Yes. Yes. It's a very good question. And I absolutely believe that it's.
So earlier than that, hopefully, since the since the peer-to-peer networking and data store would be in place above, that at least with gas-based contracts, what I call system contracts lately, that content would be accessible in large content potentially that way.
Yes.
Before it's tokenized access to content.
I understand what you're saying. Yes, that makes a certain amount of sense. There are some trade-offs there, but yeah, I understand what you're driving.
Yeah, I'm just reconciling this list with the latest diagram and the draft architecture document. And
yeah, I mean, actually, it's worth. Can you paste the link to the draft architecture document so everyone can compare?
Yes, I'll do that.
I don't see special K up there.
Essentially, that's what content delivery is. Basically, okay. Update model is special K.
Sure. Right? Yeah. Sure.
So, you know, to diffuse any worries or concerns about, you know, if I put special K there, then because there's so little nuanced conversation about what special K is, it just
to have those.
Yeah, exactly. So all right, let's see if
Can I ask Greg whether if you were unconstrained, you know, in an ideal world, given the kind of ambition and the scope of the project, would you choose four developers?
What I think is much more reasonable is about 10. And that's, for example, when I ran BizTalk inside Microsoft, 10 was about the right number, and BizTalk was roughly a third of the size of this.
Yeah, I also concur. This team's too small to possibly even deliver all these bullet lists, but this won't be the only source of funding.
Yeah, exactly. So the big risk here, if we just stick to this bare bones structure, and again, all this is doing is just justifying the $2.1 million. That I think should go into this, right? And that is like a minimum for scenario to be serious about our chain, like just bare minimum to be serious about our chain. And I think the biggest risk I have is that, you know, there are people involved. So it might take us, I don't know, 6 months to find the right four developers, right? Mm-hmm. You know, three months of you know, searching and, you know, and then closing the deal, and then you know, 3 months of really getting everyone in sync and on the same page. That can easily happen. And then maybe someone, you know, gets a wild idea and says, you know what, after I've been thinking about this, I see that there's this other business opportunity, and they leave, right?
Yeah.
right. So
yeah,
so
because on a team of four, you've got no room to carry anyone. I mean, they've all got to be.
The only thing that I can say actually mitigates that risk is, I mean, outside of budget is the open source initiative that it's supposed to be.
Yeah, so, exactly.
Brand recognition and documentation initiatives and structural organization based off of the architecture, so that we can actually get people in there and interested and point them where they need to go.
You
know, it's like the SETI at home supercomputer. You know what people can do, and with the extra cycles of their time or their computers, adds up to a lot.
Totally in agreement on that point, and that's why I wholeheartedly believe in open source. The other thing that I think is a worry and a concern for me. That's human resource related is just burnout. Under these kinds of conditions, I've tried to keep it, you know, like, you know, humanly possible, but it's still pretty, you know, sustained focused delivery over these 2 years, right? There's not a lot of wiggle room for, you know what, I need, like for example, when Jack was working on the initial Rolang design and the compiler, he needed some personal time, and that's understandable. And I think that we want to be the kind of community that supports that and doesn't you know, live by, you know, death march kinds of development. I live under those conditions, but I'm okay with that.
But Greg, I'm kind of curious what your role would be in the new form. I mean, you do a bit of everything right now because you had to. I mean, would it be more focused in this model, or do you think largely the same?
Right now, I think if we're looking at it carefully, right? So what we're talking about here in the first 0.84 million is the delivery of these two things. So there isn't. This is very, very focused.
Yeah.
Right. And in the next tranche, you know, we're talking about the delivery of this. This is very focused. I mean, there's a lot of stuff, but it's sequenced as opposed to in parallel. Mm-hmm. What had to happen up to this point was a kind of holistic view to see the whole picture and what are all the components of the whole picture, right? It's like you think about it like a musical composition, right? When I'm writing music, I can simultaneously hear the strings and the bass and the horns and the percussion, right? And I have to be able to do that, right? Because you need to have all these little sub conversations and theme reentries and that kinds of thing in order for it to be a satisfying composition. Right. So that was what was going on over the last 2 years, is really holding the whole picture and making sure that it all gels together. But now that we have a picture in place, as evidenced by the Archain architecture document and several supporting prototypes and technologies, we can sequence them and we can say, well, if we're trying to get to here, and this is the killer app for this thing, well, in order for this app to run, this thing better run, right? At least a little bit, right? Right? And then we can kind of iterate. You know, it's like the bare minimum for this stuff to run is this. Well, but then we need to really make sure that it's persistent. So let's add this. And then we really need to make sure that it's actually metered. So we add this. Then we really need to make sure that there's a content delivery model. So we add this, right? That's in a nutshell, you know, all that's going on here. There's nothing, no magic here.
Yeah, but it would be pretty cool. I don't know, even at the end of the first tranche, I mean, it's not complete, but you still got a general purpose language in a virtual machine. You know,
I definitely agree with the sequence. You know, when thinking about the architecture diagram and the document and writing it sort of from the foundation up, it starts with Rolang and RoVM and then some orchestration of the RoVM and then blockchain piece, you know, et cetera. So I'm happy with this sequence, certainly for the first three quarters of it.
Oh, very, very good. That's really heartening to hear. And I really appreciate the worries and concerns about the possible risks here. And I think that the biggest risk is that this is too much of a starvation diet. Here's where I have fallen down, and it's a common mistake I make, which is, and I mean, I want this to come off in the right way. You know, I have 30 years of experience in all of these technologies, and it has been an incredibly steep climb for me, right? But I'm the kind of person who just isn't happy unless the learning curve is always, you know, straight up or worse. So I've been for 30 years steeped in the technologies. And so when I sit down with other technical people, what I kind of expect is unrealistic. So I'll explain something once or twice and then think that I can go away and come back and then something will be done. But that's not the case. what's much more the case is much more of an ongoing, hands-on pair programming on a regular basis kind of thing.
I can certainly attest to that.
hey Gary, good to hear from you. The other day I was really grateful you were there, but I think you might have missed the moment. There was this magical moment when we were threading through like the actual end-to-end flow of data within Special K, and there's this magical moment when, you know, like the request comes in and it's suspended, you know, like it's, there's the thread in the machine disappears from execution, right? And then we put the data in, right? And then at a certain point, as you're following the thread along, you jump back into the other thread, which was rolled off to store, right? And we actually, last week, at the end of the week, we traced through all of that. And I failed to point it out to Henry and Gary. I was like, look, you see, we just did this non-local jump. Right, but those are the kinds of events that really require pair programming and sort of, you know, constant engagement. And I think one of the risks that has been the case with, you know, scenario to date has been that. And I think what I'm trying to do is mitigate that. But I don't know if you noticed, but there's no room in this budget for me. I'm not reflected in the budget. I get to starve for another year.
Well, Greg, I appreciate you mentioning that of your the learning curve and you setting the path, and it this is very challenging tech when you add it all together. You know, there's times and I do appreciate that you are when we can meet, you're always very patient with me and the developers at teaching. But and at the same time, you deserve, you know, the best in class developers in this technology that we all can find for you and for this for Arlang, our chain. Because
thank you, and I just want to say I think we have been working with best in class, and it's not that I deserve it, but that the effort deserves it, and that the community deserves best in class, best of breed in all of this, right? That's what we want, you know, as a, you know, to make sure that we deliver on these promises.
Yeah, and the best of breed on one of these bullet points is not necessarily the same talent as best of breed on another bullet point of features. So it's going to take a strong and pretty diverse team to make this happen.
Yeah. So there's another expense that is not represented here I believe can be part of a next iteration. Let me try to lay this out. I want everything to be formally verified. So specifically, I want, you know, executable specifications in say K framework and AGDA and Coq, which prove in an automated proof form the majority of the properties and claims we are making about the reliability of the software. And look, there is no room in the budget for this, right? And basically everything here follows the math, but there isn't proof about the correctness except for what we get from the operational semantics of Rolang and the behavioral type system. But there's no room in the budget here for a Coq style or AGDA style or even K framework style proof of the correctness of Casper.
Yeah, probably what would be helpful just for managing expectations with the rest of the community and making a call out to other investors is to say, here's what we have to do. Here's the milestones that Scenario is willing to pay for. And we need additional funds from other sources in approximately these amounts to make all of this successful.
You know, that's not a tough thing to do. There was, in fact, well, I mean, obviously it is a tough thing to do, but there are really cool methods like in place to utilize, like in the document yesterday was, or one of the documents yesterday, I can't remember which one, was proposed the zero net solution where they fundraise based on milestones and based on community directives. So whichever initiatives are deemed like the momentary important ones, they just run a pretty constant fundraiser to build in as they're developing their community around it.
Oh, this is something I've been wanting to do from the very beginning. When I was doing Splicious, I wanted to do that, but I wanted to do it like with a token, right? I really had hoped that AMPS would be that kind of token. So essentially, it becomes a DAO-like thing, right?
Well, and I guess they kind of were. With the you wouldn't say so with the fundraising campaign.
Sort of, right? I think it was more nebulous than that. And I think what we're seeing now with this budgeting effort and the fact that the Scenario team isn't even here in the budgeting discussion.
What's happening with that? Or what's the purpose of this meeting again?
Well, I'm available for the next phase of negotiations. I don't know where they are. Right.
I had discussions and I was feeling pretty intense about it earlier in the Slack channel. And we wanted to nail down a couple things, such as claims of IP and of legal liabilities of Scenario and of moral liabilities to the community. In that, you know, if there is an IP, who holds on to it and is Scenario at risk legally for separating at this point?
So I definitely feel that there are several important issues to discuss here. Number one that weighs so heavily on my heart is I think if you go back and listen to Dora's statements that are on record yesterday, they're consistent with statements that he's made all along and statements that have made virtually everyone who's attempted to do, you know, signed contract work with Scenario very, very problematic. And that is his claim that Scenario owns all the IP that you generate. First of all, I don't think anybody wants to not in today's market, you don't have to sign up for those conditions. But it also doesn't really quite jive with the whole open source vibe that I've been trying to create. And Yuval also, who was also one of the founders, was trying to create with me, which is that, hey, you know, this only works if the technology is open and available.
I agree completely. And just to be clear, that's why I didn't sign, you know, LivelyGig and Scenario's contract. We proceeded on a verbal agreement that, you know, frankly, resulted in some misunderstandings, not tremendously. I'm very thankful for Dora and Greg for, continuing to work with us and provide us money. I wouldn't sign that contract primarily because of that clause around IP, because I questioned about what is the intent. I understand it's sort of a standard clause in many of these kinds of agreements. So it's not unusual, but for this project and to make it a network owned by the people, it was very inconsistent.
Absolutely. But I think the thing that is more concerning is that 2 years in, we're seeing leaning more in that direction and more emphasis on that.
Right. Yesterday, I thought that Dora was upset with me in the chat during the call yesterday when I said that LivelyGig wasn't working under contract. We were working under a verbal contract, but not a signed contract. But I felt like he was trying to get me on record to say that our work or my work on the R-Chain architecture document was done under contract. And he was trying to get me on record for a reason that I didn't appreciate.
That's exactly right. And I think what you're describing is one of intent. It's the issue of intent, and that's what has made me that's one of the many, many things that has made me so uncomfortable, and why I've really felt I finally had to come clean to the community and say, I just, you know, this isn't working. We have to have some community input. Craig Sellers just took me to task for not coming to him earlier, and I deserve, you know, the lashing I got from Craig for not making the community more aware. I was operating under verbal assurances and written assurances that ultimately ended up being, you know, not fulfilled.
So, who is Craig?
Who is Craig Sellers?
Yeah, I know, but for the benefit of others.
Oh, so Craig Sellers is what, the president of Omni Foundation?
I thought he's the CTO of Omni and the CEO of Tether.
Okay, there we go. So yeah,
I'm interviewing him in 2 weeks, so I better know.
Right. So you have that. Anyway, so but moving on to the next issues around IP. So everything that's required for R-Chain was developed years before I even met Dor, and all of that was is documented in a part of the public record. And one of the things that has been a part of my strategy since leaving Microsoft is to make sure that I put out into the public domain in a way that is consistent with patent law all of the communications that make the technology public domain. So going back to 2004, you will find that I have left a cookie crumb trail of publications, talks, lectures, blog entries, and papers in, published in technical venues detailing how all the pieces fit together. So all of that, even though the blockchain didn't exist in 2004, the way we're considering the blockchain now, all of those pieces are fit together in a way to support that. The only thing that wasn't there was Casper. And Casper was clearly developed largely by Vitalik and Vlad. And I came in pretty much in the middle of that process and rethought it from the ground up with them. But that was largely their baby. And they deserve all the credit. And, you know, again, that's been made open source. You can go to Vitalik's POC on GitHub right now. And all of Vlad's publications and talks are all open to the best of my knowledge. Vlad wants this to be public technology. So we're all in alignment on that point. So that's the only piece of IP that wasn't developed far in advance of me ever meeting Dor, as is a matter of public record by design since 2004 when I left Microsoft. So people should be aware of that, and I'm more than happy to back it up. I've provided these kinds of bibliographies in the past, and I'm more than happy to do so in the future. So those are the IP issues from my point of view. There is one piece that we should think about, and that's the attention economy. And if a scenario wants to exert any sort of claims over the attention economy rather than to get my help, then I'm happy to not work on that, right? If scenario wants to say, no, you know, we own all of that, as opposed to getting my help, that's totally fine. I have a completely different idea, which I can write down for anyone to a degree of technical, to the degree that I believe anyone skilled in the art would be technically satisfied. And it doesn't match Dor's written ideas. There's at this point, there's, you know, it would be an interesting, for me, there might be some interesting discussion there around what constitutes that IP. That's the one area in with IP where there might be some murk. And again, if scenario feels that they can produce a better attention economy, then have at it. That's awesome. So hopefully that was long-winded, but hopefully I've answered all the questions around IP that were levied. Are there any, is there any clarification on the points I made, or are there any additional questions, or what's the best way to do this?
I just have a question about, you were saying, you know, that it's good to have an application, for blockchain one, and you're focusing on the metering and token.
No. The application that I have in mind is here. This is the application, right? But in order to have a real version of these kinds of applications, you need all these features.
Greg, could you zoom in your view? It's hard to read on. Thank you.
Okay, so here are the basic milestones: programming model and execution, blockchain one, blockchain two, content delivery, and attention economy. This is the application driving this, right? So before you can really do anything here, you got to have at least this much. But really, it actually has to be on a chain, so you have to have this much. And really, it has to have the metering support, so you have to have this much. Well, really, actually, you have to be able to do content distribution, so that's that much. So,
if you're building a prototype application that uses blockchain one with blockchain storage, uh, the absence of metering and token would be a problem?
Yes. For all those contracts where you have a financial or economic component, it becomes a problem.
Right. Well, I'm not considering anything like that. I'm just wondering when we can.
Right, but that's
when we can first connect a social app to it.
Oh, you can again, if you follow the proposals that I've made, you can the whole point of the work that I did on reactive media was make the social app using the reactive media design patterns. It's completely consistent with everything that's happening in the market, but guess what? It layers onto the execution model here in this perfect way. So as long as they're going in via the reactive media design pattern, it doesn't have to be as realized in Glossy Val, right? Glossy Val was just one iteration one on that. I actually think that we should have some smart dev looking at that and kind of rejiggering it. But the core idea is follow the reactive media design pattern that gets you all the way from what it looks like on the feed down to the basic API, the Monadic API that shows up in this design. So if you're doing that, then the social app can be moving very fast forward because they know what the API is from the get-go. And the API just becomes more robust and more richly featured as time goes on, which means that you can then backtrack more and more features into the UI and user experience. That's my way of thinking about this. Does that answer your question, Jim?
From both of you, yeah. So when you deliver blockchain one, which would be in 6 months?
I haven't. It's a little bit later than that if you follow the rest of it.
Okay, well, whenever. When you deliver blockchain one, at that point, if I wanted to create a, you know, a very simplified...
If you wanted
a chat system, it could be done at that point. I could make a chat system or not.
Yes, you absolutely can make a chat system. No problem.
It seems like blockchain one would need sort of a temporary token that has like a direct correspondence to gas, for example, and where it could be used by applications through the behavioral and static types. But then the metering would add, and tokens would add what in the architecture documents now called system contracts to handle the token to gas conversion.
That's correct. But I mean, alternatively, you could just have zero economic security, right? So rather than, so anything written here that runs against, you know, this level, anything written here that runs against the functionality up to here, right? What the hell? Oh, I know what's going on because I resized it. It's unable to figure out where my mouse is. All right. So anything written to blockchain one could just be run as if there were no resource constraints on execution.
Got it.
Right. So it's just, you know, right. So people can write, you know, endless loops and chew up all your resources.
Okay.
Right. And then you add this stuff and people have to pay for it. And then that becomes a measure of economic security.
Right. Could you go to the architecture document and just compare this with the diagram as well?
Yeah, I started to open that up. Let me just pull this tab off.
And then, Jim, you were saying something?
Yeah, I mean, you know, I guess the question is, you know, when can we, for learning the environment and getting into it, Obviously, the step one is good in that we can write programs.
So, just out of curiosity,
I guess the real question is when can we do something that isn't completely standalone or is multi-user anyway?
Multi-user, exactly. So I don't think we get to proper multi-user until we are here, right? That's multi-user, but it's not economically secure multi-user, because right. you need this for it to be economically secure.
Right.
Right.
Awesome.
Yeah. So I don't. So I want to be really, really clear on this point. But does someone want to pop over into Slack and see what's going on with Dor and Andy? I thought they were going to join the.
I thought I read that they said that they couldn't make this time.
Oh, I see. They can't make the time. Oh, that's too bad.
Yeah, I think they said that yesterday.
I thought they said Friday was posted immediately. Oh, okay. I didn't see that. I missed that. The Slack model is really difficult for detailed conversations, especially when there are lots of many voices in the mix. So is there a counter proposal for the next time?
I heard Monday.
Tossed back out to talk about, but no one ever came back to check the messages. Like you said, Slack is kind of
Yeah. MJ, you're echoing. Let me mute and see if others can mute so I can hear you better.
I said there was basically some open questions. Everyone was saying, well, what's the next best time? But I don't think anybody apparently came back and read this.
This is to be expected. You know, I mean, Dor is not in any rush to come to an agreement and would delay it indefinitely if he could. But I think so, you have to propose times and see when he can come.
This is Ian. Are you proposing that Scenario Ltd. is going to hire these developers, manage their contracts, and pay them, or some other entity?
It's all through our chain.
Yeah, that's certainly my understanding, is that it would be a grant from are limited to our chain co-op or whatever organization it incorporates under, and then they would pay directly. Our chain would employ directly.
That sounds right.
I use the word grant. I'm not sure what the right other terms might be, Patrick, whether it's a grant or an investment.
Well, that seems to be contingent on the on whatever, you know, whatever legal entities are established.
Yeah, I don't think investment is the right expectation. I really think grant is closer, because a cooperative is best structured with one membership class. In other words, that you know, an investor membership class wouldn't be different than a user class. Having any expectations of investment is probably wrong. I think where Scenario would benefit over time, obviously, is a platform on which to build its social network, as well as potentially supporting the future of the AMP price.
Yeah.
By making the AMP converted and useful on our chain.
Without a doubt. That brings me to legal questions that I was trying to address or that I was hoping to address is.
Oh, let me answer some of them kind of categorically.
Sure.
Dor and Greg have been recently exchanging a number of board resolutions to tighten up any kind of exposure or misinterpretation around intent around the original creation of AMPS, the Bank to the Future, iAngel investment, and a number of other board actions. Scenario does have good attorneys, and this has proceeded pretty well together as far as shoring up legal exposure in these kinds of areas. So I just want to let you know that there is activity taking place on this front. But did you have a specific question beyond that?
Well, involving the sale of equity, is Scenario LTD liable for any sort, like in any sense, legally, as a result of this split, as a result of essentially breaking the R-Chain Scenario social platform vision as a unified vision into separate entities?
I'm not aware of any. The primary one, risk I see is not keeping investors informed, which is one of the reasons, the main reason that Greg felt it necessary to bring this these set of conversations into the community light, because it wasn't happening quickly enough in a more orchestrated or controlled way. So I think keeping investors informed is the biggest class of risk, right? So,
and I don't think Scenario would be any obligation to not outsource an open source component of Scenario.
But if they collected funds under certain beliefs where while they knew that the relationship was strained or that there could be a potential break and there were situations that weren't addressed, somebody pointed out that an argument for ill intent could be made, given that it was morally irresponsible and showed disregard for someone else's well-being or something like that.
I don't think things were handled in the best and lowest risk way, but I don't think there was any malicious intent anywhere along the lines to deceive or hide information.
Yeah, and back in August, the intention to create R-Chain was announced in community meetings. Okay, and it was discussed at length in the at the Vancouver conference, all before the Bank of America sale.
That's correct. So
of course it was. But what I'm saying is, if funds were taken under the belief that R-Chain would be part of the Scenario product, is it dangerous then to separate it off as a non-Scenario entity?
So yes, there is a significant danger, as long as there is no assurance that there is some conversion event for the AMP token to some token of utility. Now, what we heard from Dor was that yesterday there was no intent for him necessarily to utilize R-Chain to establish utility for the Scenario token.
Well, it still could be established on Omni.
No, I think arguably that's not true. Other than as currency, which makes it a security, I think the risks and security issues with respect to the content delivery being separate make it such that the utility argument in that particular case is quite weak.
I understand. But, I think many, many projects in the crypto space walk this line of having a token sale before the software is supporting utility in it. And so while Dor didn't communicate a plan, I think he's aware of this risk. But I'm sure he's thinking about it.
Yeah, but the important thing is that the community be aware of the risk, right? So what I heard from David Otto when we consulted David Otto was that the strongest argument in favor of, you know, the AMP token not being a security is utility, and that you know, having the AMP token be directly related to being able to run contracts on our chain is a, you know, is the strongest argument. And after that, the ability to promote posts and things like that with the attention economy is kind of the next strongest argument, right? Now, both of those have been called into question, and it's not clear what Doar's plan is, right? He hasn't stated one way or the other.
The counter proposal that he introduced to the community yesterday stipulates that the Archain entity will develop the mechanisms required for the implementation of the attention economy and the functionality of AMP as a native currency on the Archain blockchain. AMP will serve as the only native currency on the Archain Live mainnet for the first 6 months.
So that's a proposal. But I need people to be aware that when I've gone to experts in the field, Vlad Zamfir is one of them, and had the discussion, the idea of the multi-coin approach is a much stronger solution for the situation at large. And now that we don't have a clear relationship between Archain and Scenario, I mean, right now we don't even know that there will be any relationship, right? They haven't been able to even come to the table again, which was pretty much par for the course and what I've been facing for the last year. So we don't know that there's in fact any sort of relationship here at all. And so why would Archain be beholden to support AMPs, right? I want to support a token. But I want to make sure that the people who have invested are made whole and made good. And that's why I feel the need to continue this work, is that all the people who supported this, they need to be made whole and the promises need to be delivered on. But I don't know what the relationship here is with respect to the utility of the existing AMP token.
Yeah, so I agree that Archain would be better to have multiple tokens on it. And that is probably something that kind of has to be built up front if it's possible.
Yeah.
If it's not possible, then, you know, it would be one particular currency. But even if, like in the case of Ethereum and the DAO, there could be sub or dependent tokens against a primary token. But so, yeah, and I hope that, you know, AMP becomes one of the tokens on our chain, but to make it exclusive for 6 months, I think is not consistent with the goal, which is to make multiple tokens available. Now, there, in terms of supporting a conversion, which, you know, will take a mini Herculean effort to make a conversion of AMPs or Ether or Bitcoin. But I think that's possible to include AMPs in that conversion event early. I hope that's in consideration.
Oh yeah, for me, it's definitely in consideration. I haven't taken it off the table. I just think that it's too early to say, because I've heard nothing from Doar to suggest that there is any actual relationship between Archain and Scenario. Right now it's all in negotiations and they haven't come back to the negotiating table.
All right, as things stand, it's not clear that the AMP has any utility value, right, at the moment, which unless something changes and unless there is some resolution, would put Scenario at risk of, you know, securities exchange violation for the way that the, you know, crowd sale was conducted. So I think it's a real dangerous position, you know, in terms of legality for the organization at this current.
There is real risk, but I think it's not unique to the Scenario project. Many crypto projects are kind of in this space.
Right. Yeah.
Yeah.
It's true.
Isn't the requirement to that the amp is supported, that they're proposing, isn't that sufficient so that we can go ahead and build the system that they contracted to support amps? If they do something else with the amp, that's not really our problem. Okay, we can change whatever, but we can accept that term and we can support amps, and we want to support amps, I think, to support the people who supported us. So why not support it? I mean, it seems like there really isn't any argument here at this time, except what Gore may do that could get him into legal trouble.
To recap, I think Scenario Limited does have an obligation to make amps provide utility. There's a short-term way that they could potentially do that is finishing the alpha against Omni layer so that it can be tipping an amp. There's problems with that path in that it's not going to be all that secure. The other one is to commit to our chain to make amps have utility on our chain, a converted amp. I think everyone wants amps to be a token on top of our chain, but Dor's proposal was that it would be an exclusive token for 6 months, and that's problematic for me personally.
Well, I mean, all you have to do is move that down in the timeline as to when you announce it. It doesn't mean you don't do it. It's sort of like giving early adopters the advantage. It's not necessarily a good or a bad thing, but it doesn't seem like a showstopper in terms of making an agreement.
But hang on, let's get down to brass tacks, right? I mean, they want this kind of exclusivity, but the funding proposals that they put forward are ridiculous. I mean, you saw the original funding proposals. $300K doesn't get us anywhere, right? There's nothing there that would support, providing that kind of exclusivity to that organization, because that sort of funding is not serious. They don't take it seriously, and they're not taking their own plan seriously. This is the plan that everyone was bought into, right? That we sold to investors. Right, so that's the clearest indication. Right, they put it in writing. It was clear as day. This is the kind of funding to give to the plan that we sold to investors. I think that's a very clear indication of where the intent is. If it's, I don't know how you measure intent otherwise. Right, I did was list out. Hey, let's just look at the resources for a realistic way to do this, right? I mean, I think most of the risks here are that it's too lean. That's what we've just been discussing. It's too lean. And this
that's my biggest concern, looking at that, after the fundraising, there was some comfort that the company had, enough funds to be able to deliver on its ambitions, which are pretty large. This is really meager, in terms of resources.
Right, exactly. So that's exactly what I'm saying. So if we look at this and we say, all right, just a back of the envelope, like this isn't a detailed analysis. For the detailed analysis, go look at the spreadsheet that Ed and I proposed and worked on with Gal in order to put in front of some serious investors. But just a back of the envelope kind of thing shows how laughable the proposal was. But that's not just to me, right? That's essentially what they are showing to the community. This is how seriously we take what we promised to you. This is how we will resource the efforts that we promised to you and on the strength of which you gave us money. That's how to read those documents, in my opinion. And that shows intent. And that's where the biggest risk is.
If there is an actual legal risk, and there, I think there is, in fact, a moral risk, given that we pumped it hard, like that, that's the image that, that we really sold. Because, and it was something that we believed in at the time. It's, it was nothing, it wasn't a fallacy. Then it makes sense for Archain and Scenario to stay as a single entity. They're just, I mean, if you adjust the cost to a realistic cost, right, say the 840,000 or 60 that you asked for, and everything else pretty much stays the same, renegotiate the use of the AMP on the platform, right? But say Archain can govern its own development team how it proposes, say the milestones are still intact, say funding is still contingent on deliverables, right? Then, and say that people only are accountable to those milestones and not to each other, and that there isn't an interface between you and Door, right? Then it makes sense for Archain to stay, to remain a part of Scenario. Because otherwise, I mean, like you said yesterday, there are costs of starting businesses, there are rebranding costs, there are, I mean, just operational costs out, you know, that are going to have to be recouped if it does break off. And in addition, if Scenario is, if there is a legal result, like there, if there are legal implications and Scenario is at risk, then that puts Archain at risk too, right? If there is a legal risk in breaking up the two, then it puts Archain at risk.
Well, I think a couple comments. If Scenario clearly states some intention, and this might have to be somewhat formally, that it isn't going to make claims on Archain IP ownership, and that they're free and open for what's already been published and any things that are in the works, then that removes a fair bit of the legal risks. I personally think it's not the best path forward to hope and to work on keeping Archain and Scenario together. I regret that's my conclusion, I wanted a different conclusion, but I don't think, I think Greg and Dora have lost trust and faith in each other, and that's hard to recover from. There's a mediation process that went on for 6 weeks and continued a bit after that the last few weeks. And it didn't result in agreement or establishment of more trust. So I'm sad to see that, but I'm okay now completely, and I actually think the best path forward is for Archain Cooperative or Archain organization to split off and make it as amicable and peaceful of a transition as possible.
I believe that too, so long as, again, there is no legal liability for the image that we sold to investors to raise funds. If there is any liability in that sense, in that we sold you Archain plus a social app, and now you are just going to get a social app, right? Then that should be it. Like, because else, what else? We keep the proposal the same. I mean, the proposal remains the same. The difference is that they're together and that they are still a defined entity. As far as interfacing and trust between each other, that can be done as was proposed yesterday by Andy, just through satisfaction of third-party acclaim milestones.
Subcontracting development to Archain Co-op or anybody else is not anything that would cause any misconduct of any kind. I mean, there's nothing to prevent them from subcontracting any piece of it.
That's a good point. And Patrick, you were asking earlier about the word grant didn't sit well with you, is what I was interpreting that. And so, yeah, maybe subcontract is a better word. I'm not sure. But Joseph, I do understand there is an obligation, a fiduciary responsibility of Greg and Dora's officers to make promises to investors realized as much as in their power, right? So, and I think that starts with clear information of facts and so forth. You know, there's always uncertainty about business and what will happen, you know, what will happen next about any investment.
I think Greg's condition to stay or whatever, you'll have to correct me, Greg, that Doris stepped down as CEO. I almost wanted to cheer that because my experience is, and people I know, is that getting into okay spending a nickel is almost impossible. And it would be such a detriment to the project if he were to control the purse strings, which, you know, by...
Well, as it stands now,
splitting the money for our chain off in the beginning, we eliminate all of that hassle and headache.
Well, no, as I'm saying now, as the proposal is now, he already, or not he, but the scenario community already controls those funds.
No, I mean, scenario community does not control the funds. Unfortunately, the funds are mostly controlled by Door, but it does legally it requires my approval. But I don't actually have access to wallets or bank accounts. So in that sense, he has a slight weight on this. So Door could act illegally and spend those funds. And I'm quite worried. I know for a fact that there are people who are on the payroll currently that whose SOWs I have not approved. So we're already starting down that path.
That's extremely alarming. That changes everything off the top. I'm sorry. I was not aware of that.
Christian, which aspect of
what he just said. I mean,
okay, there's two items. Yeah. And in a small company, it's not unusual that, you know, the CEO or relatively few people have control. I did recommend, by the way, that any kind of crypto assets be held in multi-sig wallets and so forth. And there, I mean, Gal is also, as a business manager or business or financial director, also has access to the fund. So that this in itself is not unusual. I haven't seen Door do anything irresponsible with funds.
No, I agree with you, Ed. I haven't seen Door do anything irresponsible with funds to date. However, there are people who are working whose SOW I have not approved.
Greg, can you stop the screen share?
Sure.
Yeah. Could you perhaps clarify what promises were made to the investors, especially regarding the platform aspects of what was sold?
Say one more time, please.
Okay, so the equity investors, they bought into the Scenario Social Network, but perhaps also a little bit more into the layer cake, like perhaps a layer that enables several applications to share in the social network. But were the equity investors promised a piece of the underlying layers of the platform down to the wire? I'm talking about the storage and the networking and social and contract aspects of what would be our chain.
I think we've addressed this conversation in public before. So no, the equity investors were not promised any direct access to revenue streams coming off of those, of any of the technologies, all the way up to the top. No equity investor was ever promised a direct cut off of revenue streams from any layer of the stack.
So that includes the transaction fees. This is kind of stuff that I was harping on for about a year.
So equity investors have a right to some kind of dividend or return on the profits of the company that doesn't give them the access to the revenue streams themselves. The company acts essentially as a kind of buffer between those revenue streams and how investors get paid out. Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think that's helpful.
So we have somebody in the community saying on YouTube here, I understand our chain was part of the whole platform when I bought Amps. I think he's referring to the crowd sale. Is that true? Was the Bank to the Future literature selling the R chain blockchain as part of the package?
What? Just restate the question for the record, please.
Okay. So There's a guy here on YouTube right now. He's saying, I understood that R-Chain was part of the whole platform when I bought Amps.
Thank you. I believe that everyone understood that. And for Dor to represent otherwise or to fund, see, this is what's so important to me, right? We can now see as clear as day, absolute clear as day, what scenarios intent is with respect to R-Chain, right? So everyone got to see yesterday what scenarios, what Dor's proposal, this was Dor's proposal, which he then ran by other people, what his proposal was with respect to funding that effort, right? And then what the exercise that we went through at the top of this meeting was to go through what an incredibly impoverished resourcing would look like.
Well, Greg, I
and they're basically an order of magnitude off.
Greg, I don't think you should summarize and judge what Dor's intent is, but
it's important to understand. So in general, I don't deal in intent. I only deal in results.
I know.
Right. So, but here it's important to begin, you know, like after you work with someone for a few years, you begin to get a picture of intent.
I see. That's just to give the other perspective of this, you know, Dor also, you know, founded the company and sold investors a social, decentralized social network and so forth. And I imagine that he's torn and mixed about wanting to deliver both, you know, the R-Chain stack as well as a decentralized social network. And so probably is, you know, allocating funds in his head across both of those projects.
So I understand what's being said, but even like it's perfectly reasonable to say to investors, in order to get the car built, I have to have a really good carburetor design, right? So I'm spending the first 6 months with all my best engineering talent on the carburetor design. That's a very, very reasonable strategy that's kind of been time tested, right? And I'm not saying that we have to put our chain first. What I'm saying, and in fact, I've said quite the opposite with when we look at the milestones in the sort of back of the envelope budgeting exercise that we just did at the top of this meeting. What is clear to me is that scenario doesn't take our chain seriously, as is and we saw the kind of we saw the kind of discussion that went on from Andy. So we can conclude that it might be that, you know, Dor is saying that he doesn't take me seriously. And that's, you know, that's a reasonable position for Dor to take. He could be saying, I don't trust you to deliver our chain. And I'm happy to address that. But right now, what we're seeing is Dor does not take our chain seriously. And Andy in elaborating the position and getting a little more wiggle room, also didn't take it seriously. If we just look at a basic, you know, back of the envelope style budgeting, right? And again, I did this completely neutrally. All I did was go through the architecture document that is here. That Ed, I'm sorry, I'm not screen sharing. Let me screen share. Hang on a second.
You know, talk about intentions and other things is, No,
this is
making judgments here is not really going to give us an agreement. I mean, we know that there's distrust from both sides. We have to work in spite of that, and that means that we have to get the money separated up front.
I agree with you, Jim. But the question on the table again, this is not about me having trust or lack of trust in Dorr. It's not that at all. I'm just calculating here. I'm just doing math. So the question on the table was, what are the risks, and how are those risks related to what Scenario promised investors? So here is what Scenario promised investors, right? This is the document that went out to investors. We are hearing back from people who are investors that the reason they invested is because of the ideas, concepts, and prototypes related to this document. That's what we're hearing back from investors. So that's, again, this is just, it's just a matter of public record.
Well, I don't think it's all black and white like that. I think in addition, yes, all that's true, but in addition, a decentralized social network was promised, and it might be the case, and I'd love to hear it from Dorr, yes or no, that he's planning on building a social network sooner on some other platform in order to make good on the social network aspect sooner, possibly. But I'm interested in hearing what he has to say on that.
That's pretty much what he said, Ed.
That's what I thought I heard.
So again, if that's the case, then the risks that are in place are the relationship between our chain and that social platform. Right. That's you know, at a certain point, you know, we've seen how hard it is just to get people who are working day to day on a code base to kind of come together on various things. So my sense is if that's what happens, then we will have a major divergence, just both in terms of cultural things and other things that will happen in the accretion of development. We all know this. We know how this happens, right? Right. Unless there's a much.
Yeah. Well, you know, the question is, right? You know, the big question is what will they develop port easily onto the R chain or not?
Well,
if not, we can be about 95% certain that it's going to be a lousy system that's not going to go anywhere, and they're going to have to rewrite everything on the R chain anyway.
Well, I mean, I don't want to make judgments that way. All I want to do is to say that the risks come out to be questions about the utility of AMP and questions about, you know, sincerity with respect to this document, which were sold to investors. Those are the actual risks that, as I can see them, you know, on the ground. I think with a budgeting like this, what is left over after the 2.1? So after fees, I think there's actually only a little over 3 million left after all the fees and everything and expenses. That's what Dorr told me. There's only a little over 3 million of the 4.7 that was raised. If 2.1 is spent, and this is extremely lean, is spent on our chain, then there will be roughly 1 million to develop out the social application. And again, that can be done in a staged manner and in a way that they can proceed in parallel, as I have outlined. And I believe that the budgeting is realistic for that. And if we budget that way, we can turn around and go back to more serious investors and get the remaining funding so that we can do both in parallel.
Right.
And that's what I feel like I'm just, you know, repeating myself again and again and again. But I believe that the facts bear out in favor of this basic way of carving things out.
Yeah, I think the repetition is actually good, Greg, because occasionally there's a different viewer or a different participant in the call or a different context. I think the repetition is completely fine.
Okay. All right. Well, thank you for saying that. So anyway, you know, I realize that it's 12:26. I'm sorry that the scenario people couldn't be here and that they haven't proposed an alternative time. So I don't know how to proceed.
Well, I would suggest, Greg, I mentioned this in the phone, I think earlier, yesterday or today, that you put together a complete proposal. So this plus the document Dorr sent with a timestamp, making it clear that it's a proposal, you know, from you to Dorr and the community, and put an expiration date on it. And then that gives him an opportunity to have a counter proposal or accept it.
Okay, that seems quite reasonable. I mean, I
think it would be useful if we're going to, reconvene at a time when Dorr and the scenario team are going to be present. If we suggest that, you know, we've seen Greg's plan, but we haven't seen much of Dorr's plan. So I think it'd be interesting that we ask that. That's also presented, you know, if Dorr wants to go with a different stack and replace the CTO and those things that he mentioned in the other meeting, we'd need to see some more detail about those plans, right?
Yeah, I think that's a reasonable ask. Okay, so I'll do that. So in the remaining just a couple of minutes before I suggest we conclude, here's what I'd like to ask is just at a rough level, what are the high level bullet points that turns this into a proper proposal? One thing I heard, hang on, I'm going to have to make this small in order to type properly, have the mouse work. All right, so one thing I heard is IP. So IP needs to be clearly stated.
Yeah. You can use the below the insert menu. There's a zoom picker. That one will allow your mouse to continue to work.
Let me try that. Oh no, it seems to be way off.
Oh well.
I think it has to do with the interaction between this and.
Okay now.
Okay, all right. So I'm using keyboard instead of mouse. Okay, so IP needs to be clearly stated. What else? So there needs to be good for, you know, X hours.
Yes. Or yeah.
Okay. Anything else?
Yeah, Patrick. In fact, in exclusivity of amps is a negotiation point. That how is it exclusive for how long?
Okay. There's that. Anything else?
Timing of when the organization would be created or when this deal could be concluded, you know, the intent should be that this deal would be concluded within, you know, 2 to 4 weeks.
Ah, okay. So
as opposed to 3 to 5 months or whatever.
January 1st is a good date.
The selection. Yeah, that's not a bad date. The selection of who judges the milestones, you probably should put in the proposal of, you know, Vlad and Vitalik as acceptable options. And maybe, you know, maybe there's others. Maybe Craig is a trusted person. Maybe I'm a trusted person. Maybe there's others on this call that could be trusted to help judge the milestones. Mm-hmm.
I think a sealing of the funds. So because you get more money in time, and they had to be put in escrow.
Right.
Okay.
the proposal needs to be clear about the amps as part of the incentive as well. You've said USD is the most clear, but or important, right? But amps shouldn't be ignored in terms of amps as incentive.
Yeah, fair enough.
Is there going to be any sort of planning, or will we cross the bridge when we come to it in terms of if a deal is not reached, what do we do?
Good question.
Sorry to drop the bomb, but someone's got to have a contingency plan. This is not a joke, guys. I'm sure you have way more on the line than I do, but damn, dude.
That's a great question, Christian. There's a negotiation thing called the best alternative to a negotiated agreement. I'm not sure what Doors BATNA is. Greg, one thing that you haven't made clear, but I think Door has made an assumption about, is if our chain cooperative forms a separate organization, would you stay on as an officer of Scenario?
That comes down to the AMP exclusivity. So if there's going to be realistic interchange between the application and our chain for the first year or so, I think that I have to have some kind of technical role.
Yeah. So one thing you could put in this agreement is to say, the following topics are not part of this agreement. Whether or not Greg stays on as an officer, what the technology is for Scenario social application. That's an independent roadmap decision that Scenario Limited could make, I guess, or those kinds of things, and see if people agree that those are out of scope.
Okay, cool. Good. Anything else that people want to see in the proposal?
I guess I'm very curious. I'm sorry to be up in your business, so to speak, but why aren't there more public meetings?
Christian, I am so glad you said this. Yay! Right. So let's take a look at the difference in methodology here. So this is why I don't ever want to be a manager, right? Because I'm absent-minded and I'm forgetful and I got way too many things on my plate. So all I did with respect to this meeting was to throw together everything, put on paper everything that I said in the last meeting with respect to, basic budgeting, right? That's all I did, right? And I just put it down on paper. And then I justified that in terms of the existing documentation, right? And then I invited the community to have a discussion of the proposal and to give their input. That's what I think is the way this whole network ought to run. And look, I think we're converging towards not only a document, and in a very short period of time, by the way, in just a few minutes, really, by wall clock time, we have a document that's beginning to have a common understanding around it and some consensus around it. So I think this is the right thing to do. Now, by comparison, Doerr kept his proposal to the very last moment against his chest without any sort of community input.
Which may have been up to 2 weeks in length, right?
That's correct. That's correct. So, by the way, the budget, all of this is informed by the other spreadsheet that I shared with you last week that went which had tons and tons of effort put into it. All of that was from my point of view, it was simply as the legwork and homework to then turn around and go back to the community and have public meetings. In my opinion, our chain wants to have public meetings and wants to have input. And I'm going to be perfectly blunt about this. I think that's the best damn marketing you can do. When people feel they have ownership, they feel they have a say in the product, when they feel they are fully informed and they can be engaged at the level that fits and suits them, that is absolutely the best marketing you can do. I don't believe that that's cynical, because it also achieves a second end, which is that you have a community. So that's, you know, I fully support that style, and I don't think that it has to be knocked down, drag out. I don't think it has to be I don't think it has to be anti-agile or be too slow. And this is an example of what I'm talking about.
Greg, on that note, please add to your list about defining community ownership and control, and perhaps even putting some time parameters on it. Because although in Scenario, you have repeatedly stated your intent that the project should be owned by the community, controlled by the community, it's got no teeth to it. So how about in this next agreement, putting some teeth to it?
Well, so I think the way Dor has sidestepped that issue is to leave all governance discussion over to Archain. That's the way he sidestepped that. So Scenario maintains essentially, if I leave, then Dor has zero oversight. There's no board, there's just Dor.
I think this agreement is primarily about making this acceptable to Archain. And what Scenario Limited does in terms of its openness and so forth is going to be largely up to Dor.
Yeah.
Right. I don't know that we can, you know, get him to commit for those things. He's going to act like he has acted, or get another community-facing person to help with these kinds of things.
Right. But I think right now we have about 2 years worth of behavior to go over and comb and see what's real and true. That's my sense of things. Me leaving Scenario essentially solidifies that, which is why the scope here, I think, is critical, as you brought up, Ed.
To amplify what you just said, Greg, I have maintained archives of everything that I could scrape from the Slack and from Lumio and quite a few emails, and I'm under no non-disclosures. So if you want help in backing up anything that you've just said, I can offer that.
Okay, I appreciate that. Thank you.
And I'm more than willing to go back. It would take me probably a month to do, but to try to transcribe everything so that we can have historical reference of what has been said over the last year and a half. I know that process probably stopped maybe in April, but I think it's healthy. I think we really do need to timestamp statements that are publicly recorded. So if it's helpful, I can also commit to something of that nature.
Okay. All right. So, I mean, I think that's kind of, you know, I want to deprioritize that to getting to a point where I think what's most important in all of this is that the community state as clearly as possible, I invested for Archain, fund it seriously, right? That's numero uno, because if that's what the investors state and there's a clear message that way, then it's very clear what will happen if, where the weight or gravitas of actions needs to be. So that's numero uno. Now, the second point is to make sure that this budget, which, you know, has been open for discussion by the community, this proposal is codified in a proposal, and that Scenario has a chance to respond. And after that, hopefully we can come to some kind of agreement. I think those are the top three things that I think need to be done, and roughly in that order. And those are the outcomes I'm hoping for, is that there's a clear indication of what the priorities are from investors in the community. That indication is reflected in the budget that is and proposal that's put in front of the negotiating parties, and hopefully that becomes the means by which we reach an agreement. So does anyone have any, you know, final comments? Is that seem reasonable or you know, anything else you feel like really needs to be said?
Yes, there are two more points to add to the list.
Okay.
It's about the release of funds. Okay. You have to arrange that it's immediately released when the judges say a deadline has been qualified as done. And final decisions have to be done live in a live meeting.
Yeah. Nice. I like that. I like that idea that the final decision is agreed upon in a community meeting. That's very nice. Okay. Thank you, everyone, for participation. The proposal structure has improved dramatically as a result of everyone's input, and I really, really appreciate all the scrutiny and attention. The thing that's I'm most excited about, I don't know if you guys saw this, but you know, we're already at a point where we've got at least one language compiling against our virtual machine, right? If we go here and say compile and then if I say let's say there it is. There's a little tiny program, continuation passing style factorial, compiling against a virtual machine that already has concurrency built in. So we're way, way, way ahead of the game. If you go and go back and look at the things that we were just considering here, right here. So effectively, we can see this, you know, like the 0.75 version of this tick done, right? And the Rolang design is already in 1.0. We only need a compiler from that to this VM, and that's something that can be done along the lines that I was talking about. This is the kind of thing that makes me excited. It's real progress. It's technical progress. And it's marching towards the specific goals and aims that we promised our investors. So with that, thanks to everyone. And I'll hopefully within Slack, we can find a time where we can negotiate again.
Yeah, Jet Greg.
Yeah.
Can you hear me? Dorr said he would be available Saturday, Sunday, or Monday. I really think you should propose a time or two, Sunday or Monday, since he mentioned those 2 days.
Hey, Greg, I think that if this is your top priority for the moment, you should be meeting with the community every single day. And then whatever days he's able to show up, he shows up, and let that be a testament in itself.
Okay. No, I think I'll take that on board. If people want to meet, at 11 a.m., I can't do it on Saturday because I have previous commitments and I try to make that family time, but I can certainly do it on Sunday and Monday. So if people want to meet at 11, tomorrow, Sunday and Monday, that's 11 a.m. Pacific Standard Time. I can do that, Christian. I don't want to sign you up for stuff that you can't make. Do those times work for you?
11 a.m. tomorrow, we are doing an interview with Augur.
Okay.
Okay,
so we can work around that. How? What if we did our meeting at the community meeting at 10?
Yeah, that works. And it's obviously the same room, so I'll just jump ship right into once he comes on. So
is that too tight?
I mean, are we gonna stick to an hour or
we can stick to an hour for sure.
Is that acceptable for everyone?
Yeah, I probably can't make it tomorrow, but might be able to be there for a few minutes.
Cool.
Okay, cool. So I will, I'll definitely, what I can promise for that meeting is to have a, is to have an updated form of this proposal for scrutiny and consideration. And
we know Doris not available tomorrow or Saturday.
So. Oh, wait, I thought you said he was available Saturday and Sunday, or Saturday, Sunday, or Monday.
No, he was available. He's available Sunday or Monday, he said.
Okay, then again, we can. Christian, are you okay on Sunday at 11?
I believe Arcade City is being interviewed again for their follow-up ICO meeting. We're doing follow-up. So, sorry, I'm cracking the whip on all these projects, man.
No problem. I'm very excited. What about at 9:30 a.m.
That's fine. Yeah.
Okay. All right. So, all right. So I can make that time on Sunday. Finally. Oh crap. What about 8:30 a.m. on Sunday? That's Pacific Standard Time on Sunday morning.
That's fine for me logistically. Technically, yeah.
That can work or not? I didn't quite hear
yes.
you.
For me, technically, yeah, that can work.
Okay.
So that would fact, I really do think it is now time for me to perhaps share some techniques with other people that are capable of doing live streaming so that we have some redundancy. I use open source technology. I have a better rig to do everything. I'm mobile. But I think sharing the tools will help enable anybody to operate.
Feel free. Go ahead and use set up a channel in the RChain Slack so that anyone who wants that information or to get up to speed on that you can use that.
Cool. Yeah.
Yeah. I can do live streaming. I would just need access to the account. If I just record it in the Zoom, it can be posted later. It's not clear that it has to be live streamed. Since,
let's have that discussion.
Anybody?
If I just out of courtesy to others, if we could have those discussions offline because but yes, I think that all of that's good stuff. Let's definitely do that. Okay. Thank you to everyone. I promise. So tomorrow we're doing it at 10, right? Just double checking. Tomorrow at 10, Sunday at 8:30. Is that correct?
That's fine for me. Yes.
Okay. All right. So I'll be there at those two times. All right, guys. Let's keep rocking.
Cool.
Bye.
Ciao.